reached the final presentation, and maybe my favorite, it's Michael J. Pupin. He was actually the teacher of Armstrong, so the generation before. And I myself will introduce him to you and ask my colleague, Andreas, Hillman. So Michael Pupin was a real Renaissance man of the 19th and 20th century. He invented many different things, and one of his early inventions, I think even during his PhD, was these Pupin coils, these loading coils, used for long distance calling. Here you see an example of a large antenna was put on the, by AT&T on the in a building in New Jersey, considerably enhancing the distance you could make long distance calls. Here is a later version of the car antenna on a police cruiser, just probably outside of our building right now. AT&T paid him a total of $25 million of today's worth money for his patent on this, which basically made him a rich man and put AT&T on the way to really dominance or as one of the large telecommunication providers today. But as I said, he was a Renaissance man and he did a lot of different things. For example, he served as the founding member of the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. That later developed into NSA and to the NASA. It's in 1915, that's a foundational meeting. He is here on the right. He advised President Wilson on the drawing the Yugoslavian border after or during World War I. He was very devoted to his home country, Serbia, and they put him on the 50 million dinar bill here in 1994. You see, there was inflation going on at that time. I think they And on top of that, he became the Pulitzer Prize for his autobiography, which he was awarded in 1924. But perhaps the invention he's most known for is actually in the field of medicine. And in order to understand that, we have to kind of, we really dug deep into Columbia archives, and we looked at it, if we can find some material that can illustrate that. So here you will see 1901 movie or clips on a first sales pitch of the first X-ray machine to Columbia, and after that is a brain imaging procedure. Listen closely. The quality is not all that great, but it's has been 110 years. Let's go.
It gives me great pleasure to present today the Edison X-ray photographic apparatus. Evelyn, if you will be so kind. One places the photographic plate here, while the patient's afflicted limb is then placed on top of that. The X-ray tube is then activated, and the result is the X-ray photograph, a peerless tool for medical diagnosis.
Now, if you would, put that plate up to your face. Good. Now, the trick is to stay as still as possible for the best results.
X-ray imaging 120 years ago. So luckily, we have Columbia engineers. Pupin found a way with the fluorescence screen to reduce that from an hour to about a couple minutes per 10 seconds so that you wouldn't have to stand there for an hour holding the X-ray. Here's an example where it's used for image-guided surgery. Basically, he has shrapnel or these lead bullets on the buckshot and the implant was taken in 1997. So, today we still work on imaging technology, and Professor Hillman here has taken brain imaging to a whole new level, and she will talk about that now.
Thank you. So the tradition of medical imaging really lives on here at Columbia NCs, and particularly in the Department of Biomedical Engineering, where we have experts in ultrasound, medical image analysis, optical imaging, and the machine-brain interface. My own work focuses on brain imaging, and in the last year you've probably heard a great deal all about the brain and why brain imaging is important. But why might that be? So here we have our lovely lady, one of the most enigmatic gazers. But what is she thinking? That's what we've always wanted to know, right? Well, how do you figure out what's going on in somebody's brain? Well, we're fortunate that we actually have a technology called functional magnetic resonance imaging, which lets us look inside the brain and would let us see which area of her brain was lighting up and what she was actually thinking about when this image was being painted. But functional magnetic resonance imaging has a bit of a dirty secret, which is that it doesn't really detect neural activity, it detects changes in blood flow. And I became very interested in what was going on there in the brain, how were the neurons talking to the blood vessels. And as a physicist and an engineer, I was really quite horrified that we really didn't understand how the brain feeds itself, how these pipes and this infrastructure of the brain was actually meeting the energetic demands of the neurons that were firing. And so I started out sort of wanting to understand that better, to give us better ways to interpret these kinds of images and to help the neuroscientists and the physicians to really understand and interpret these kinds of images. And we also now believe that this could be a really important component of understanding brain diseases. And really, ultimately, we both want to understand the human condition. We want to understand why the brain makes certain decisions, but we also need to understand what goes wrong in the brain when the brain is diseased. And in order to understand this, my lab, as engineers, builds microscopes. So here's two of my students putting together a fancy microscope here. And what we're able to do is collect things like this. So this is a high-speed, high-temporal resolution image of those blood flow changes occurring in the brain, essentially when the brain is having a thought. That's what's happening to the blood vessels. We can use our other imaging techniques to do microscopy. So this is looking at single cells in the living brain, looking at blood vessels, and the way those cells are integrating and talking to the blood vessels. And in our most recent imaging system, this is a volume of the brain that's being imaged really, really fast. So basically video rate imaging in three dimensions. And so following in Pupin's footsteps here, we're going about 100 times faster currently than the currently available microscopy technology. And this is something that we're trying to commercialize now. And so using these tools, we've made some quite important discoveries in the last year, particularly that there's a particular layer of the blood vessel called the endothelium that we've identified as being really important in regulating blood flow. And that sounds kind of maybe not especially interesting, but it provides us with an actual link between things like cardiovascular disease and diabetes and brain disorders and cognitive decline that is seen in those conditions. In looking at this during development, we found connections that could lead us to understand disorders of prematurity, autism, and ADHD. And then looking at the aging brain, there are direct links between what we've found in the vasculature of the brain and some of the problems with Alzheimer's. And between Alzheimer's, autism, and ADHD, these are all things that are currently having a huge impact on society and are really important for us to understand. And if we're going to understand these conditions that really affect the human brain, we have to find ways to actually also image the human brain. And so in a recent collaboration, we've taken our imaging technologies up to the hospital, highlighting the collaboration here at Columbia. So this is actually a picture of the human brain during neurosurgery, where the surgeons have opened up the brain in order to look in to remove a tumor, and we're able to use our technologies to actually understand what's going on in here. And so what we've been able to find in one of the patients was alterations to the vasculature that actually gave us an idea of what was going on with the tumor and could give us new ways of actually detecting tumors and understanding what's going on using, again, back to functional MRI. And with that, I thank you for your attention, and I think it's been quite interesting.